This is the Adelaide Championship Wrestling Heavyweight Champion, Redshaw, and you are watching CCP Podcasting. Make sure you like and subscribe because you do not want to miss what these guys are doing. That's for sure. That's for Redshaw!
What is happening, friends of CCB Podcasting? Welcome back to Beyond the Bell. My name is Chris Pates. That handsome gentleman with a long, luscious beard, that's John the Beast Cable. What is happening, dude? How are you? Are you ready to rock and roll for another episode of Beyond the Bell?
Man, you know, I always am. I love these interviews. The chatty nature of guys around rings is always fun to me, and talking to people that are involved in the industry is a blast. It's a good connection for us, and it's always fun conversations. I like to pick their brains a little bit and ask questions they didn't expect, so you know that I am always ready for another one of these.
Well, today is no exception. This is another one that I've really been looking forward to for a plethora of reasons, all of which we'll get into in the midst of our conversation. Ladies and gentlemen, our guest today, if you paid attention to anything WrestleMania weekend, then you saw a viral clip of the sickest pile driver on the face of the planet. That was done by our guest today. He's Rico Gonzalez. How's it going, man? How are you?
Yo, happy to be here. Appreciate y'all for having me on. We finally made it. We're here, and I'm ready, man.
Yeah, man. We crossed paths the same way that I crossed paths with just about everybody, except yours is a little different. Owen Knight is somebody that we did a show on. And that's how, you know, I can't remember what the conversation looked like or what the DMs looked like initially, but that's how we kind of came together. And if you're watching this show now, which, you know, you are, because, hello, Rico's here. You should have already seen his live spotlight video. Rico joined us on a live stream. That spotlight was released on Monday. I suggest and encourage you guys to go take a look at it because there's a lot of tremendous talent outside of Rico and his body of work. So this is our second conversation, and we held a lot back for when we did our live stream because that was, for us, was new. Usually we'll do our interview, and if you have a good time with that, then we say, hey, if you want to come and do a live show, you can, but you were the first, I think, that we had on a live show watching this stuff back. So, first of all, thank you for that, because it was arguably the highest drawing spotlight show that we have done on that channel today. That's all
because
of you. And I say that because we've talked to so many different talent, and there's a plethora more that's coming. But it's kind of hard to get a lot of the retweets. Like, guys, you know, they're busy. You know, the guys and gals are busy.
Yeah.
I get it. But you went out of your way to share just about everything that was posted, and I really contribute that into the success that we had with your live stream. So I want to thank
you for
that. Before we get started with anything, I want to say thank you, because it generated some stuff for us. And as long as we can recoup and generate some stuff from you, it's a win.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Appreciate you guys for that. The competitive nature of me is so happy right now.
Well, we're already starting off.
I love that.
We're already starting off. We're already starting off on good foot.
I would just thought to, like, that was directly from Effy, actually. Effy, every time we're on the show, he always tells us, hey, guys, even if it's not yours, if it's part of the show, like it, retweet it, comment, bookmark, whatever you need to do. And just not to take social media too personally, because it's still a bit what you're doing.
Yeah.
And, like, it's important to not take it. I don't know. Once he said that and he was like, don't take it so personally, it's part of your brand. It's part of your business. You have to push it out as much. It's all about the numbers and stuff. So I just took it that route. I'm not even the biggest social media guy anyway. So, like, I was like, here, like, share, retweet, comment, whatever. Like, it just helps, you know. It helps everybody. It helps you guys. It helps me. It helps independent wrestling. It's a no-brainer.
Yeah. He says, I'm not a big social media guy. It has a massive social media platform.
Man, if I didn't need it, I promise y'all wouldn't be.
You're preaching to the choir. I think social media is the bane of all existence now, but I'm old. Yeah. So I'm that guy that's screaming, get off my lawn. Enough with the formalities of catching up and all that good stuff. Let's dive in and get to the business at hand, man, because, like, you've been in the business for a little bit now, a couple years. Before you got into the industry, everybody had somebody within professional wrestling that they're like, I want to be like that guy. So who were some of the guys that you grew up watching and that inspired you to take up professional wrestling?
So the first two guys, it's always my one and two. I always put Shawn up there at number one, Shawn Michaels. I feel like that's a lot of guys' number one. And number two is Undertaker. Those are my one and two. Three, four, and five, as far as my top five, kind of switch around here and there. But those are my top two. Those are the guys that I watch.
Ends of the spectrum, too.
Yeah, but they both just, like, give you – those are the two guys that I always knew when I would turn the TV on. I cared about what they were doing. I cared about who they were feuding with. They made me care about the people I didn't care about. I was just always invested in what they were doing. And they were the first two guys that I saw that were what we know now is over. And, like, just, like, everybody's eyes were on them. Everybody cared. And everybody stood up and made noise, you know? And that was the intriguing part to me. Like, who are these? When I first saw them, I was like, who are these people? Why do they care so much? Why does this whole arena care about this one guy walking around right now? It was so intriguing to me. Those are my two.
Yeah, one way or the other, if Shawn Michaels or The Undertaker is coming down in the ring, you either love it or you hate it, and you have an opinion, and you know what's going on, and you definitely are invested right now. Well, one way or the other.
I remember Taker when he debuted. I was 8. Scared the shit out of me. And then, of course, Shawn Michaels. Yeah. I mean, that was my first crush, so... Hey, I can't on Shawn Michaels being the number one. That was when I realized who I was when I saw Shawn.
Yeah, yeah.
It's an interesting contrast because, John, you said it's on two different sides of the spectrum. Shawn Michaels is the entertainer, the charismatic, and Taker mm-hmm. is just, you know, no words really had to be said. He just went
the phenom. He is what he is. Yeah.
And I could see a little bit more HBK in you and in with your in-ring work than I can with Taker.
Yeah.
But just based on what I've seen, you engage and you love the crowd and you love whether you're being cheered or you're being booed. You just love feeding off the energy. So I could see that. I could see those guys being two of your top influences. When you decided to go down this road. What were your steps? What did that look like to you? How did you when you decided this is what I want to do as far as training? What kind of research did you do? I know that we know that you came from A.R. Fox's school. What led you to that path?
So I always had it like in the back of my mind. I always I don't know if y'all play the WWE 2K games or like back then SmackDown versus Raw or mm-hmm. whatever. You always have your creative character. So, like, I had that before I had those games. I had that creative character in my mind all the time. Like, I would just walk around and I would hear – or I would hear a song and be like, ooh, that'd be a good theme song. Or, like, I'd walk around and, like, do my little entrance. And I'd be like, oh, this would be a cool finishing move or, like, a signature move. Stuff like that. I always had that, like, whenever I would start daydreaming or, like – going into my own world, that's just always where I went to. I would always create a faction, create a character, do all that stuff. But I never really was like, I'm going to be a professional wrestler. That wasn't like in my mind as a child. Like I know a lot of other people say, since I was born, I wanted to be a professional wrestler. That wasn't me. I was always raised in a traditional Mexican household, work hard, find a job and raise a family. You know, that's how I was raised. So it was really once I was older that I started just like I would be in bed sometimes. I'd look up professional wrestling schools just for the hell of it. And WW4A always came up. It was always there. So I would like click through it and look through the website. You would see Apollo Crews, Heath Slater. Later on, you would see Austin Theory came out of that school. A lot of these big guys. So seeing that, I was like, I'm definitely not going to do professional wrestling. These are the people that are coming out of professional wrestling, you know? And the people on TV you see are like these big, huge guys. So I was like, that's – but I didn't know – come to find out that the I didn't even know the indies existed. Like later on, I found out people in WWE that were that did the indies, but to me, I just didn't. I don't know. I didn't like link it, or I didn't put the pieces together of how that worked. It was just like a foreign land to me.
It was probably just to the beginning part of internet marketing for indies.
Yes, absolutely. Like
there just wasn't a presence.
Yes.
And that's a thing that indies really struggle with and always have. There's no presence. There's no monetary power to the marketing pen.
Right. And then it's kind of like the Wild Wild West. And then I know that now to where everything is like kind of on their own. It's not like a big – not everybody doesn't come together and like makes it a thing. Until I guess now a little bit more with streaming and stuff.
Oh, it's starting but, to. We're seeing
it. Yeah. Right. But so I looked up WWA4. And I made a friend in, his name is the Renegade Enforcer. He trained at the WW4 also. And he invited me one day. He was like, hey, come through to the school show. It's real fun. It's real cool. He knew I was a fan of wrestling. And, I grabbed one of my best friends and we just grabbed a few drinks, showed up and just, every Thursday they had a free show. And it was the most like, up front in your face, I don't know if y'all been to an indie show, but it was my first indie show, so it was like this is such a vibe. It's so fun. It's like right in front of you. It's so interactive. It was way different than TV wrestling, and it made me love it even more. So that's how I got in connected with the WWA4.
I almost giggled for a second, but because you wouldn't know this. So and you're like you asked if we've been to an indie show. John and I have both seen a lot of ring time in our younger years. That's why we're drawn to what we're doing, man. And it's once you get bit by the bug, it's done. It's over with.
Yeah.
Right. And
right.
It's almost like it took you going to the show to see the environment and the atmosphere. And I'm assuming the arena that they film out of or is where they do their training, which is where you had your match with AR Fox, just so I can get perspective.
Yes, no.
Okay, so the building was different. All right. But you got bit by that bug, and the rest is kind of history there. Did you kind of figure by the time that show was over that, all right, I need to ask here? Because I could see where the hesitation would be getting into the business, because it's always been the big man's game up
right.
until the last, you know, 10 years, 12 years.
Yeah.
You know, AJ Styles is one that I credit that shift to with his run with the NWA TNA and into TNA. And you know, athleticism is a thing. And the big guys aren't, you know, there are some athletic big guys out there. There's
right.
not a lot that can do what you guys can do. And I take it you probably, when you visualized it and you saw it, oh, God, there's somebody my size, and he's doing a moonsault. He's doing
yeah. fucking,
you know, it draws you in. So I'm glad to know that that's kind of how you got started. It was the taking it all in that atmosphere. Right, because it's a totally different ball game, and I'm going to throw it over to John real quick because this is going to open the doors to training, and John's the training guru on this show, so I'm going to throw it over to him and let him pick your brain a little bit on how all that went down for you.
Yeah, no, he was working in the Alabama circuit. I was working in North Florida and South Georgia circuit, and we both have our our chaps busted in the indie scene ourselves. So no, we get that entirely. And like he said, that's kind of what brings us to what we do now. You know, once I know he did the same thing with him. We went to a show and that was it. Mine, for me, was the last ECW show in Jacksonville before they broke apart. At the Morocco Shrine Auditorium, I saw Sandman and Tajiri and Dusty and Dreamer, and I saw all of them do their thing.
That's
and
that awesome,
was it
for bro. Me.
It was over. I was like, I have got to. And then I go out to my car that night, and there's a flyer for a training school here in town, and I was like, oh, I'm done. Within like the next week, I signed my contract. I started paying my training fees. I was in there. Then I did about 10 years. I know his wasn't quite as long, but he had a few years in there too. And that carried me from working security to training in ring to running the creative department and booking matches on the fly at the table as a commissioner. So like I've seen that whole indie drive like do what it does. And this is why we are as passionate about the industry as we are, because we've both been in it and we love working with it and talking about it. It's just what we do. And that same passion is something that you also have. You can tell in your matches, you can tell in your crowd interactions, you can tell when you're watching back your stuff. But you really do enjoy this. And that's one of the things that we appreciate about you and why we're so glad to have you on the show. But like you were saying about training, so you had known that the school existed. You went to the show. You saw the thing. You had to get in. What was the point for you when you were like, no, this is what I'm going to do forever? Was it early on, or was it after you graduated and had a few matches, or was it just the instantaneous bug? When was it for you?
So it actually took a minute because I went in and I was still like, okay, I see a smaller guy, so this is possible. But I just want to be around it more. Not necessarily in ring per se as a wrestler, but like I just want to be around it more. So I came in and I started training as a ref, and I'm like, okay, because on the website has they do everything on when we do the Thursday show, we have people training to be a ref, we have people training to be commentary behind the camera,
yeah, what have you. I'm glad that they have all of those positions that they're training for. And what's the cross-pollination for that? Do you have a lot of the workers that are also learning the other trades, or do they pretty much absolutely just stick to the ring?
So before you have your graduation match, you're in there jumping in as a ref or holding the camera, doing commentary. I feel like everyone there has done all of it. Like, everyone good there has held a camera, everyone there has done commentary, everyone there has been a ref. Yeah, I feel like everyone's done every position there.
That's awesome, because it's so important to understand what those roles do and what their jobs are. And the only way to really know is to do those things. And for a guy to get into the industry and never touch a table, never touch a mic, never touch a camera, is like, you don't even know what you're performing for, how it's going to look on film, right? And you should. And I'm super glad that the training that you got involved all of those things. What was the hardest part of it for you? Was it the ring work, or was it being in front of the camera, or what was it for you that was the obstacle that you had to overcome to get through the bit?
So I feel like just once I started training, well, to start with, I came in and I told Fox I want to be a ref. He ended up training me as a wrestler anyway. So I was in there doing the rolls, the drills, taking the bumps, all that. Thursday was my training for the ref on the live show. That's just how Fox is, just to throw you in the fire type of guy. That's how he trains. That's how you learn with him. But as far as the most difficult thing for me, I want to say it was commentary. Like, once you have your character and like you know what you do, it's fine. But like looking at someone else and breaking down their match, staying on topic, making it sound interesting, also covering up when they're not doing well, that is a task, man. That is
and
just
doing
like,
it in character while you're also like it's a lot going on.
Yeah, for me, that's always been like the hardest thing, because sometimes I go into like play by play, and I start calling the moves, and I'm like, all right, but I have to like talk about the story that they're telling, or you know, this or that, whatever they're doing. Or sometimes they're just not doing a good job, and you're like,
it's students. That's what I tell myself. It's students. gotta give them the benefit of the doubt. Real quick for context purposes.
No, that's interesting to hear that you're. Let me, for context,
you mentioned Fox. We're talking AR Fox. Context purpose. AR Fox is who changing?
Yes. AR Fox is who's been my only trainer so far. I've taken seminars and like gone to other people and advice and stuff, but my trainer is AR Fox. Yeah.
Okay. That's what I thought. I just when we say Fox, I was like, let me make sure we at least get his name out there just for purpose sake. Because he's got his hands on a lot, man. He's trained a lot of solid talent. That's definitely a school that I would be looking into, right? Like, it sounds like you made the right call there. John, what were you about to ask him?
Well, I'm actually going to pivot a little bit because you said that you took some seminars and stuff, and we've been seeing a lot of guys do seminars. What do you think the most beneficial part of being a part of the seminar circuit has been for you? Like, what's something that you've taken away from it that maybe really opened your mind to a different part of the industry?
There's so much. The first thing that comes to mind is really just getting someone else's perspective on stuff. Like, Box has told me some things like probably 20 times, and it didn't click for me sometimes. Like, something that he's told me, I'm like, okay, yeah, cool. But like, sometimes we just say, yeah, we don't understand exactly. Like, that it just takes time, you know? But then somebody else will say the same exact thing to me, and I'm like, oh, that's what he meant. Okay, that's what he meant about do this or do that or do this in a different way. So that alone, just somebody saying this, maybe the same thing, but just in a different way, has helped me a lot. Wrestling is subjective. So like, some people care about something more than another thing, or some people just enjoy a type of wrestling more than another. So you get their perspective on stuff or their way of doing things. Or sometimes you just hear something you've never heard before. Fox is a great trainer. I love Fox. I've learned so much from him. Fox alone can't teach me all of wrestling, you know? Mm-hmm. So I've learned different stuff from different people, and I continue to learn different stuff from different people every day in every match.
Well,
That's awesome to hear you say.
Yeah, I was about to say, that totally makes sense. We had the opportunity to sit down with you and watch your graduation match with AR Fox. Now, I think that is very interesting on two fronts. And guys, you can go relive that by watching the spotlight video. It's his main event on his show. That you go in as a referee, he trains you as a wrestler, and when you finish your training, you're putting on a 30-minute match with him. As part of your graduation. You know, like,
a banger too.
Appreciate that. It's Fox, man.
I'm just saying, like, And I know it wasn't all him, like, making you look good. You held your own in that. Like, I wish I would have had that opportunity when I was in the industry. Of course, times were different, and you know, it wasn't – we didn't have, you know, 15 or 20 people. We were lucky to get, like, six. And of those six, maybe one would make it through camp. Like, it was just a different ballgame. But putting you getting in the ring with him at such a young age, young in your career, man, it's got to help build a little bit of that confidence that we see today. Because I don't know how many people were in that class, but I know that every one of them had a shot with Fox at that point, but he chose you. Like, there's got to be a reason for that outside of the talent and believing in you. So when he comes to you and says, for this show, like, you're the guy. What's going through your head there, and how important at that point was that to you?
That was probably like it was surreal to me. Like, that I was like me? You sure? Like, you sure you want to do, like, I don't know. it's also Fox has taken so many people to their best match. Like, Fox is a genius. It's crazy.
He's an unsung hero, in my opinion.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And in my mind, I'm very competitive. I'm very, like just, how do I even explain? Like, I'm just, I go for it. Like, I'm not going to say no. You're giving me an opportunity, I'm absolutely going to take it. Sometimes I'm, most of the time I don't, but sometimes I will sink. But that's just because I just go in head first. And I'm like, we'll figure it out as we go, or we'll figure it out when we're in there. But I'm not saying no to an opportunity. I've never said no to an opportunity. So I was like, absolutely, I'm going to take that. Like, hell yeah. And it might make some people upset. I'm sorry. But, like, what am I going to say? No? Like, no, I'm not ready. I don't think. No. I was like, hell yeah, let's do it. Let's go. Like, if I'm not ready, I will be ready that day. And if I'm not, I'll figure it out as we go.
Well, at the end of the day, it's a business, right? Like, now this is business for you. You know, so
yeah.
If people get upset or they got mad about it or want to, you know, whatever, like, you know, if the shoe is on the other foot, I'm pretty sure you're going to say yes. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, that kind of stuff just irks me a little bit, because it's like, come on now. When you, John, what you got? Because I see your wheels turning.
There's a billion things in my head. So transitioning from your graduation into being in the business, how did that come about? Like, how did you manage to – did you stay working with AR Fox's company? Did you go out and branch into other companies? Did you try to book yourself all over? What was the process for you to get into the industry?
It was such a learning curve for me because, mind you, I didn't know the indies really – like, I didn't – know of the indies a few years before that. Now I'm just figuring out the indies exist. And then I'm like, okay, so now I know they exist, but how the hell do they work? Like, what do you, like, apply somewhere? Do you talk to somebody? Or I didn't know.
How did that process work for you? Like, how did you figure out how to get yourself booked? How did you work that into your schedule? How does that look in your first year?
So I have always said this, and I will always say this. God has always taken care of me. He's always blessed me, and he always puts the right people around me. So I had people around me telling me, hey, hop in this car with me. We're going to Florida. And I'm like right now? Yeah, we're going to Florida right, like, this weekend, and we're going to do the show. I'm like, all right, cool. Hop in. You go set up a ring. You go talk to the promoter, and you might get a match. You might not. When you do, you hope for the best, you do your best, and from there you got put on, and that's what happened. I had my graduation match. Very next day I was told, hey, let's go to this promotion, and they have a tryout show, and that was Action Next Up. And showed up, set up the ring, got a triple threat match, and I was absolutely terrified of having this match and calling this match. I just had a singles match, and now you're asking me to do a triple threat, and I don't know any of it, but always been blessed, always been taken care of. Ash Bennett, one of the trainees at the WW4A, was in that match, and he's like, think of three things you want to do. Think of some little, like, funny spot you want to do at the beginning, your cool moves, I'll put it together. Puts it together, super easy, match goes well. And that from then on, it was just like hopping in cars, going to promotions, just living the rock star lifestyle that is independent wrestling.
That is indie fed. So you paid your dues roadie working?
Yes. For sure. Well, I would say in some promotions, till once you start meeting good people, you start having matches with people that are in higher caliber and in higher places, you do well. Then they start putting in a name for you. And that happened, I want to say, with the next few months into my first, second year.
Well, let's relive that. What was the situation?
So, there were so many people that I came into contact with. One of the main people towards the beginning was Ashton Starr. Here out of Atlanta, my fiance AC Mack and Dylan McQueen. which is based out of Knoxville. Those three saw me, took a liking to me, and they were like, you're doing really well. Hop in a car with us. We're going to New York. We're going to Chicago. We're going to North Carolina. And to me, it was crazy, like, the first year to be, like, able to go to these places. Because a lot of people build in their town first to begin with, you know? Mm-hmm. But, and I was like, I probably should build here in Atlanta. But also, I'm not saying no to going to New York and getting a match. Like, you know?
Exactly.
So, yeah, so that was, those were three key people in the beginning. Jaden Newman, based out of Chattanooga. He runs TWE in Chattanooga. He told me, hey, come up. Whenever you come up to Chattanooga, you have a spot on the card. And he saw me at the Action Next Up show. People over in Alabama. His name is blanking, right? Brandon Williams helps run New South. He told me the same thing. He was like, hey, come to New South. Whenever you come, you have a match. And then one of the biggest key players a few months in was Brogan Finley and Billie Starkz. Mm-hmm. Once I got connected to those two, it was all like more opportunities, more promotion. So I just a little bit of all those people helped me just branch out to all the promotions that I'm at right now.
Well, it's interesting because they're, you know, you say that the, you know, your first three guys, they took a liking to you to get in the car. Well, one of them you're marrying. I think that's great. Second piece of that is, I was going to jump into some Billie Starkz stuff because that was something you did talk about a little bit on the live stream that we did with you, and it was that your match with her, like that it was one that was very special to you, and it was a solid match. And it's, again, guys, it's on the spotlight video. Talk to me a little bit about what that meant for you at the time, because it's, you know, Billie Starkz is great. Let's just call that right now. Is top, in my opinion, one of the top tier female talents in the industry right now.
Absolutely. Billie, to me, meeting Billie was like life changing, because anybody that knows Billie knows the type of person that she is, the type of people that she's around. Is like her mom is the GOAT. Rebecca, shout out to Rebecca. She is absolutely an unsung hero in indie wrestling. And she hates if anybody talks about it, but she's always helped me. Like, I love hanging out with her. I was hanging out with her this weekend. She lets me stay whenever I'm Midwest or any of that area. She lets me stay at her house, always takes care of us, always makes sure I'm good with promoters and stuff like that. Just a good person all around. But that match with Billie Starkz, she absolutely did not have to do this. She came to my training school, wrestled me for free, mind you, at a time where she's like probably her and Mike Bailey, two of the most booked people on the indies. Mm-hmm. At the time before she got signed. And she was like, yo, you are my favorite wrestler and I want to come wrestle you at your school. And I was like, hey, you don't have to, but I'm not saying no. If you come by, I'm absolutely wrestling. And I thought she was just saying that at first too, because I was like, this girl is just so damn busy. Like, there's no way she's coming to training school to come wrestle. But Billie Starkz is, there's very few people that love wrestling more than Billie Starkz. Like, that girl is just lives and breathes professional wrestling. So she lived up to her word. She came to the WWA 4. She had that match with me, and from there on, I feel like I just took off. At least my career did.
Yeah, I think that's – I mean, when you have someone that caliber that comes to you and says, you're my favorite wrestler, if that's not – you know, if you seek validation in any form or fashion, if that's not that answer and that's not that validation, I don't know what is.
Right.
I mean, she is tremendous. We've done several shows on her. John, sorry I dominated for a minute or two. Go ahead.
No, you're fine. No, that's awesome. I'm so you get, you know, realistically, I think wrestling and dancing are very similar. You could be the best dancer on the planet. If you have a great partner, it makes it better. And I think that's the key to that. And I think that you've been lucky enough to get the particular opportunities that you've gotten with particular people like Stark, to get eyeballs on your product and what you're doing. And it's been a stepping stone for you to get where you're at. How do you balance your schedule with the rest of your stuff you got going on? What do you do for like gym time? What's a day in your life look like?
Oh my God, bro. I am the worst schedule person ever. Like, balance. No,
I get
like,
that entirely. I'm the same.
Balance to me is, I don't even think it exists in my world. No, I am lucky to have a very, very great and organized fiance. He puts this, I like send him my stuff, and sometimes I'm like, he's going to get mad at me one day and just like stop doing it for me. So I have to stay on his good side. But I just like, I'm like, hey, I have this show, and he'll put it on my calendar that we share. He'll put all like every day that what time I work. He's very like OCD, so his world has to be organized anyway. So he just puts every day I work to what time I work. What he told me I have this thing, this podcast today. He reminded me. He tells me what shows I have, what I need to book, the flights, all that. Like, he helps me stay on top of that organization. As far as the balance goes, I think I'm sometimes I'm. So I don't tell everybody this, but I am 30 now. I just turned 30 this year, a few months ago. Everybody thinks I'm younger, which
secret's out. You just let the cat out.
Right, breaking news here on this podcast. No, everyone thinks I'm like 22, 24, which is a blessing. It's great because they think I have much more time, and it's a blessing. But no, I am 30, genetics. But I have, thank you, I have this mentality, or I still think I'm like 18, 19, 20, and I think I can do everything. So just like today, there I'll schedule a million things. I'm like, okay, I have work. After work, I'll hit the gym. Then I'll come back, and I have to clean my car for this weekend. And then I have to pack, and I'll have to do this podcast. And it's just like every day I get to the end of the day, and I'm like, bro, you can't do everything. But it's like, I just like do it again.
Five of those things on my list, though.
Right. So it's just balance is like something I think I have to grow into still.
Well, I understand.
Heard.
I tell people all the time, I didn't become an adult until I was 32. So I think I've been adulting for 8 years, 9 years now, and I still haven't gotten the hang of it. I'm
still. Yeah,
my life goal is to never be the most adultiest adult in the room.
Hell yeah, bro. I'm there with you. I'm there with you. I told Billie Starkz' mom, Rebecca, that this morning, or the other day I was hanging out with her. I'm like, you're a for real adult. I'm an adult, and I feel grown, but sometimes.
Yeah, you're grown. You're like she's a for real adult, right? Yeah, I'm not ready to adopt that A word yet. I don't think I'm there either.
I'm the lowercase A. You're the uppercase A.
Right. Hey, you got it figured out. I'm still like having fun.
Well, let me shift gears for just a second because you know something that. I mean, the people on our channel obviously know my situation is I'm an openly gay man as well. I want to talk a little bit about the differences between when I was in the business and now. And I think it goes back to one of the first messages I sent you. And I was just like, listen, as a gay male, I love the fact that there's a lot more representation for our community, and that professional wrestling is more accepting of it now than it was back in my day. And I wanted to see and kind of, you know, discuss a little bit about what that scene looks like now, because now almost quarterly, Effy's got a big gay brunch going on in a different city. Which, you know, all this stuff wasn't around 20 plus years ago. So what's that like, and what's that look like to you to represent the gay community?
So coming in, I didn't realize how important it is to represent the gay community, and important to be the most true to myself that I need to be. Because I didn't realize also how many people are watching either. Like, how many people really watch your stuff. I don't realize, and sometimes I still don't realize the reach that I have, or that you guys have with this podcast, or that we have on social media. Like, there's a lot of people that see my stuff that I'm like, when I'm in ring, I really only think, okay, only these 50 people are watching, and then however many online, like a few other. But it's, I'll go to a different promotion
with the internet.
It's crazy. It's crazy. And as far as the gay community right now, it's so much more open. It's so much more accepting than what the stories that I've heard are crazy from my peers and people that have been in the industry just like even 10 years ago, maybe even 5 years ago. It just became a little bit more of a safe space in the past five to 10 years, I would say.
Yeah, 20 years ago, there wasn't a lot of safe to it.
Right. Like, the stories I've heard from my peers are insane. Like, just how they were treated, that they were kicked out of locker rooms, they were beat up. Just like, I mean, also the world was in a different place. So,
yep, that's
the world in general, not just wrestling. So we had people like Effy, we had people like Billy Dixon, we had people like MV Young, AC Mack, Ashton Starr. I could go on forever, but these people that just became pioneers and like really opened those. And I always see people like talk about they opened doors or they paved ways for us, but I didn't realize it how important that was until I am where I am now. And now that we have a platform and we have a voice, it's so important. And just a lot, like when I posted our proposal pictures mm-hmm. on my social media, and I'm open now. Maybe like, I don't even think 10 years ago I was openly gay, or at least to like all of my family or the internet world.
Yeah.
I did post before my proposal pictures. I had posted somebody I was with before. That was the most terrifying thing to me, like posting online, just being openly gay with another guy, and like for mind you, people that you don't know see it, which is one thing. But then people that like in my family didn't know, that was crazy in itself. So come fast forward to. Was it last year? When did I? Oh my God, he's gonna kill me when he sees this. Last year I proposed, I think. My mind is like it, but when I proposed and we posted those pictures, I was very scared. Like, I was thinking, well, at least we'll get a little bit of hate, we'll get some love, and you know, it'll be that. Everybody will know. I just posted it, kind of like threw my phone away. Like, all right, here world, and I'll go back to my phone later. But to come back and to see the amount of love and support that we got, and if there was some hate, I honestly didn't see it.
It got drowned.
It got drowned.
Like, exactly the way it should be.
I did not. And it was the reception that we got was insane to me. I didn't realize like how many people like just were going to react to it. Just all positivity. And it goes back to what I was saying, the reach and the importance of being your true self is, because I would go to other shows and I would make my entrance. And I'm in character. Sometimes I'm like even heel and I'm walking out and like doing my thing. And then you get in the crowd, hey, congrats on your engagement. And I'm like, how the hell do you know? Like, and it just didn't click until like, I'm like, wait, the internet exists. And like, people saw this shit, but I didn't realize like me posting here, people like across different states, like are paying attention or watching it. Or I even got, my favorite one was, I was heel at a promotion and I go out and making my entrance, you know, I'm like telling myself I'm a badass. I'm about to kill everybody. Like, you know, mm-hmm. like in character. And then I hear someone in the crowd, hey, congrats on your engagement, you piece of shit. It's like, I almost broke in that moment. I'm like, this is that's awesome. I love that.
No, go ahead.
Yeah, it was. It's just I went all over the place with this question, but it's very important.
It is.
The representation is very important. I didn't realize how important it was. I'm still learning the importance of it, and I'm still growing and learning and trying to be my most true self.
So what I think is great and just fantastic about all this is, you know, the reach that you do have, and not just you, any other wrestler, or not. Let's not trivialize it to wrestler, athlete. Any other athlete on the planet that is gay or LGBTQ plus, you're showing them and those that are working and in the industry and in the sports field, anything, you're showing them that it's possible. You know,
doing it with class too.
Exactly.
Appreciate that.
And you don't ever know, like, the way I look at things. You know, what we say today is going to affect somebody tomorrow. It's going to happen. And we have the opportunity to be, you know, a hero or a villain in any story in life. And I remember, like, when I was a kid, like, I kind of realized my situation when I was, like, in middle to high school-ish. But, I mean,
yeah.
It wasn't discussed. It wasn't talked about. It wasn't. Just different times.
Right. Same.
Nowadays, there are still people out there and there are kids out there that are getting bullied, that are getting, you know, bashed and this, that, and the other. And if they watch whatever, if they watch you guys out there representing that community, it's going to empower them. It's going to,
right.
Somebody tells you that you're not going to make it. You're this, that you blah, whatever it could be, whatever negative space that's being thrown at them. You guys are a shining example of, no, this is possible. You're breaking ground, and you're doing it in a way that I feel is going to touch generations to come. And, you know, not to put any more pressure on you and others, but, like, it is it's something to really think about, because it's in a world that's full of hate. It's very easy to hate what is not considered normal. And first of all, what is normal? Normal doesn't
exist. Right, yeah. Yeah.
Normal doesn't exist.
Normal doesn't exist. And if anyone tells you it's your normal, then tell them to fuck off, because they don't know the first thing about life. But I say all that to say, like, the impact that you're making, guys like your fiance, and those that paved the way for you to get into and be open and be honest with yourself and the world, like, it's going to give somebody out there that is experiencing a hardship or, you know, God forbid, do something, you know, think about something stupid. They could look at this and say, this is possible. I'm sorry, that was my rant.
Yeah.
I get one of those a show, I just used it.
No, you're good. I've gotten that. I've already gotten those stories, like, being at different shows. I'll have people come up to me and be like, hey, I just had somebody a few weeks ago say, hey, my daughter came out to me because she saw you, and it gave her courage to come out. And, like, to me, that stuff is crazy, because, like, I'm just wrestling, you know, I'm just clocking in for another show.
It goes to what you said earlier about the training. You get the different perspective from somebody else. Sometimes it takes hearing the same thing from someone else to give you the push to do the thing that it makes it click. So being an outlet like that for someone to hear it's okay to be this way, maybe that's the one time they needed to hear it from somebody that they look up to get it through their head that this is okay for them.
Right, for sure. And it's just, it's so, like, it puts it into perspective differently for you, because I'm like, okay, just like how I was saying, it's very important. And just going back to what I was saying about being your true self, that's something that I was struggling with when I came in, because when I came in, I was like, I don't know how I can be in the locker room. I don't know how, and, like, I should maybe shy away from talking about it, or, like, all that stuff. And then you meet all these people. You meet Effy, and Effy's like, I don't give a fuck about these people. Like, I'm going to be me, and I'm going to do me. And if they hate me, they hate me. And they don't have to watch me, but there's more people that love me and that care about me for being my true self. So that stuff is like, it really changes your perspective, and it changes other people's lives. So that is way more important to me than sometimes how I feel, you know, how I feel about what somebody thinks about me.
The realization that somebody hates you is also the realization that you've made it big enough that someone will hate you.
Yes.
Well, you mentioned Effy, and I think that he is kind of like a flag bearer, if you will, of making our voices heard. And I say our voices, right, as far as on the independent scene. How did you come across him? And, I mean, obviously I've seen you attached to several of the big gay brunch events. I would imagine that crew, and I got a chance to watch a good piece of the one in Philly. I haven't seen all of it yet, but I did get to see a nice little piece of it. I'm assuming that crew kind of runs together on those big events, or does he bring in? Is it a kind of like revolving talent that comes in? Because you seem like you're a staple with it. So how does that connection happen?
I hope so. So I want to tell this story correctly, but I have the worst memory. I want to say it was Dylan McQueen that vouched for me early on. Dylan was always fighting for me to be on shows. So I remember I hopped in the car with Dylan. We rode up to Chicago maybe two and a half years ago now. And it was like Deathmatch weekend for GCW. Or they're always having death matches, but at the time it was like Art of War or whatever, and they had like they'll have like a War Games death match mm-hmm. that they'll do in Chicago regularly. So it was that weekend. I think it was called Art of War or something like that. We show up, it's maybe Friday. I don't remember the date, but let's say it was Friday was the GCW show Friday night, and then Saturday morning was brunch. Dylan McQueen's on it. I ride up with him. We get there during the show. Dylan's crazy ass grabs me, and it's like, we're going to the locker room. And I'm like, okay, I'm not on this show. I don't think I can be there. Like, nobody knows me, but whatever. He grabs me, goes to the locker room. Goes in front of Effy. Effie's music is about to play, and he's about to go into this two ring death match cage thing. And Dylan's like, "Hey, this is Rico, and I want you to put him on Gay Brunch tomorrow, please. He's really good." And I'm like, Dylan, like, right now is not the time to be talking to this man, and like, he's gonna hate me forever. Like, why are you talking to him right before he goes? And Effy, in the most Effy manner, he's like, "Yeah, cool. Send me your info. I got you. I'm about to go out and do this match, but we'll talk right after." Goes into the match. It's like bleeding, has all this glass. It's like, "Yeah, I'll put you on tomorrow. I got you. Just remind me, because I'm going to forget. Just remind me." It was like the craziest thing. The next day gets here. Effy has no sleep, and he's like super grouchy. And he's like, "Hey, I'm sorry. There's no room for you on the card. Can you help me sell these pastries?" And I'm like, "Sure, I'll sell these pastries for you." Like, yeah, I mean, it was just the most bizarre, like, first meeting of somebody. So I sell pastries on the first gay brunch, which was their brunch. Like, they had the mimosas, and then they had little pastries and stuff or whatever. After that, he put me on the next gay brunch, which was in Dallas. So that's how I met Effy. That's how I got connected to him. Luckily, he's vouched for me. He's put me on, I want to say, every single one that I've been able to make.
Yeah.
But it is, you asked another question. It is a revolving door of talent. There is staple talent, but it also is like, sometimes it depends on whatever region they're going to. They'll get gay, because now we have gay talent all over the United States. You know, there's much more talent. So, sometimes it's talent within that region. Sometimes it's just revolving talent. But luckily, the ones that I've been able to make, I've been on.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, you went viral Mania weekend. When I say I saw the sickest pile driver, Jesus Christ, I woke up. So first of all, I'm not usually up past about 9:30 or 10. I'm told you, I'm gonna get off my lawn guy.
He's the old man that goes to bed by 9 o'clock.
Mine's 11. I'll get to 9 in a few years.
No, I'm telling you, the older I get, this seems like the earlier I go to bed and the earlier I fucking wake up, dude. I'm tired of getting up at 4:30. It's for the birds.
Oh, that's crazy.
I know. You're preaching to the choir. I get it. My ADD kicked in. I forgot where I was going.
He'll be getting up while I'm going to bed, because I don't go to bed till 4 or 5 in the morning. He's already getting up to go to work.
Something like that.
That's insane.
Yeah, it happens. I forgot where my question was going to go. ADD.
You were talking about the viral video of Gabe Burton. Sorry.
Yeah. The pile driver. Yeah, the incident.
The incident. Yes, the incident. That's what we're going to call it.
I wake up the day after Mania. I forget which night it was. It may have been Sunday morning. Was that a Saturday show that clip happened?
It was a Saturday show. Yes, okay, yes.
So it was that Sunday. I woke up and literally, I'm not a big social media guy, but have to use it just like everybody else does. And the first thing I see is the viral clip of that sit out. I mean, it was like a superplex turned into a sit out tombs. I don't know what the hell you call it, but it was the nastiest. One of the nastiest spots I saw all weekend, and it was so beautiful. It was just the execution of it. How did it feel to wake up Sunday morning knowing that something you did Mania weekend went viral?
Oh man, it was it's just the best feeling ever, because the amount of talent that is in just that building alone, the amount of shows that GCW ran that weekend is crazy. I don't know how. Brett the Booker, I don't know how he does it, and I just saw him throughout caffeine. The whole weekend. I kept looking. I want to say a little more caffeine, but I will say it's caffeine. I looked over at him and I'm like, this man is about to just spaz at any second, but he kept his composure the whole. If he did spaz or go off or go crazy, I didn't see it. I just saw him cool, calm, and collected over there in his quarter, sitting by CM Punk at one point. Sitting by half the WWE roster during Bloodsport, and then just a revolving, like we were talking about, the revolving door talent, just the amount of talent that was in that building. So to get a viral clip that weekend feels really good. I didn't even realize. I was just going in just trying to have a good match and make a cool moment,
I mean, you did. Clearly, I told you before we went on the air that, or before we started recording, it came down to the two clips that I got the most kick out of was you and Darice. I think it was a sit. I don't even know how to call it or what to call it. Your maneuver.
What do you call it? It has to have a name.
So I haven't given it a name yet. It's very new. It's has to be called the incident.
What happened? You just got hit by the incident. That's your bad. It's not mine. Of course, Man Like Darice, his
clip. Shout out Man Like Darice. I'm such a fan of that guy.
I'd love to. That's one of my dream matches right now. If I can get you and Darice in the same ring at the same time, man, that would be fucking
fun. Oh, I would love it. And we've been in a scramble here in Atlanta for GCW, and that's how I got to know him, because I didn't know who he was until it was maybe last year. I want to say GCW was here in Atlanta at Center Stage, and I remember I asked the promoter, I'm like, who's in the match? He's giving me the list of people, and he's like, Darice is in it. I'm like, I didn't want to be that guy. I'm like, who? But in my mind, I was like, who's that? So he comes in, gets there a little late. We call the match, put it together real quick, go out there, we're first. And he comes out and does his entrance, and I'm like, who the hell is this guy? Like, just gets the whole crowd behind him in like seconds.
Yeah, that's a pop and a half, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's crazy. I'm like,
the lyrical dragon.
I waited. Yes, I went and followed him. I've been following him ever since, and I'm such a fan. He's so good. he just gets it. And you can tell with that viral clip. I'm jealous of his viral clip because I want a viral clip like that. Like a cool move is cool. Yes, I'm super grateful, super glad that I got it. But that moment when he did, I love it. It just popped me every time, and it kind of breaks my heart because I was supposed to be in that match, and I had a bit of ideas, but I couldn't make it.
Yeah. That clip was good. You just got to think in the future when that opportunity arises to do a spot like that, to call it. Make it happen.
Yes.
You can make it happen. John, go ahead. Let me come around to you, bud.
So we've talked about your training a little bit. We've talked about how it is to get into the industry. Now that you're in it, like, what's the biggest draw for you besides, like, you know, being in the position that you're in? You know, because we all get to be on the TV and we get to be on the thing. Where's your goal at? What's the goal marker look like for you for your career? What do you want to accomplish, like, for your end game? What's the plan down the road?
Right. So this is going to sound kind of hokey and it's going to sound kind of like, really, my goal is just to enjoy it as much as I can, have fun with it, just get be able to represent my people both in the LGBTQ plus community and the Mexican community. Just being able to touch lives and have as much fun. I'm already further than what I thought I was going to be by, like, leaps and bounds.
I know the way of it, though. Like, you see yourself becoming a thing, and then you end up over here, right? And you're like, oh, wait. How the hell did we get here?
I'm gonna blow your mind real quick. So what you just said is you're already, you know, well ahead of where you thought you would ever be. If this doesn't blow your mind, nothing will. Think about how good you're going to be in 4 to 5 years. If you're where you're at right now, and you're ahead of that curve that you've set for yourself, whatever that looks like for you, think about where you're going to be in 4 to 5.
Right. And to me, as you say that, I think about the people that are on the indies right now, the amount of talent that's on there. And I just look at them. I look at, like we were talking about, Darice. I look at people like Darice. I look at people like Billie Starkz, Speedball. My trainer, AR Fox. Well, he's on TV now, so I guess. But I look at these people and I'm like, damn, I want to be that good, you know? Like, I want to just absolutely move that needle on the indies, or, like, walk into the room and be able to just have that crowd in the palm of my hand. I, like, that's my goal, I guess. I guess I'm figuring out my goal right now as we're talking. Because, I mean, everybody has – not everybody now, because times have changed. Everybody used to have that goal of wanting to be a TV and getting that contract. If that happens, so be it. I obviously, I would not say no to that. I would love to be on TV. If it doesn't happen, I'm okay with that. I'm okay with being on the indies and being one of the top indie guys. I'm perfectly fine with that. I just want to be really, really good at what I do. And – to me, that's successful. Being happy with what I produce, and hopefully at one point make good money off of it, whether it's on TV or on the indies.
You see, it's like this, like you just mentioned it, like with whether you get on a, you know, a television deal or get on TV or not, the independent scene is, you know, John and I have said it several times. We even think we talked about it briefly off air. It's like a modern day territories. Right now,
yeah.
And if you're good, the cream always rises to the top. You can make a good living on the independent scene and not have to touch a contract and be your own boss.
And, you're like, never before that's a possibility now.
Yeah. It is
eerily reminiscent of the territory days in the 80s. I'll tell you like this. Like,
and that's so exciting.
It is. It really is. And I'm like, we talked to pull the curtain back. We talked to Cha Cha Charlie last night out of Florida for his show that's coming out. It's already out as time this airs. And he and a guy named Skrilla. Well, you know Skrilla up in Atlanta.
Yeah.
All right, so we've hooked them up. Skrilla was like my dream opponent. Well, in Florida, there's a guy named Cha-Cha Charlie. I'd love to work with him. We had already built a relationship. Put them together, all right? You could take that, and if they were to work a story, and the same thing can be said with anybody right now. You could take a story from state to state to state to state to state to state to different indie feds and make a really good living. I think that it's – and I think that we're just scratching the surface.
We are. That's what I was saying. It's so exciting because we are scratching the surface of, like, it's just an exciting time right now. It's an exciting time both on TV and on the indies. Just the amount of talent that we have on the indies that has just a wealth of knowledge. So the rise of streaming, the rise of social media, how connected everybody is, how, like, you know who the top of the indies or talent is.
In other has definitely found itself.
It's crazy. Like, you know who's top talent in Japan and Australia and in the UK, Germany, like, now. Like, you can just look them up and just research and go down a rabbit hole of what they're doing there right now or like, in the past few years. Like, it's crazy, and it's so exciting just to have that. And just how, like you're saying, we're just scratching the surface of it.
Well, you said going down the rabbit hole. Welcome to our channel. Because this rabbit hole has
been, that's exactly what we have.
That's it. Like, it's so, we say that professional wrestling brings people together. This case in point, we just recently got connected with an organization in Portugal. Like, we stumbled across one of their live shows. We watched live indies or we pull random independent shows for our Monday nights. We happened to stumble across it. And
that's awesome.
Their Fed showed up. Like, and you know, it's shit like that with the way that the internet.
I need y'all to send me this stuff. Any of the cool stuff that y'all have, just send it over to me.
Okay. I mean,
there's tons of it.
A lot, you know. We try to be different. Like, we try to be a different kind of podcast. And, like, reality is everybody knows that you're a wrestler. Everybody, you know, you have a deeper story. Well, for me, at least, as a host of the show, just because I represent the gay community and I wave that fucking flag, right? So it's like we want our fans of our channel and our viewers to get to know you a little bit, right? Like, what makes you tick and all that good stuff. Wrestling's a piece of it. It's not all of it. You have trials and tribulations. You've rose through situations and circumstances that most of us probably can't even fathom. And here you are. And this is it's a much bigger situation. I want to touch on this real quick. John, and then I'm going to come over to you. You've got a wedding coming up.
Oh my god!
Welcome, welcome to the club.
Yes, I got two rings now. Actually,
I saw you. You got your other ring. Is that the actual? Oh, yeah, that's the.
This is my.
Which fed's that from?
Midwest Territory Wrestling Champion is now a ring. It used to be a chain that I had, but it's now a ring. But yes,
Rico, two rings in the house.
Yes, sir. But yes, I am getting married, which is, like, it's crazy. You know how we were talking about being a real adult earlier?
Yeah.
I feel like that's a little step of me being.
I'm going to guess that you are not the wedding planner here.
So I would have guessed the same, but also I have been planning most of it. Believe it or not, I've
going for you.
So I kind of had my first little breakdown yesterday of, like, we need to get
the Bridezilla
things.
Story. I need to get it.
We need to get things done. We were, like, sitting on the couch watching TV, our usual, you know, like, decompress at the end of the day, have a drink, like, chill. And then I just started spazzing. And I was like, we need to get this venue. I was like, why haven't we picked the venue? And he's like, It's going to be in July because we're getting married in Puerto Rico in June 20th. That's with our close family, and then July we're hosting like the ceremony or like the party. It's not nothing crazy, but something here in Atlanta for everybody else that can't make it to Puerto Rico. So it's that one that I'm like, we don't have a venue, we haven't picked anything, you haven't looked at anything. Like, we need to do this right now. Like, it was like 9 p.m. and like a random Tuesday. I'm like, we need to do this right now, and he's like, we need to figure out the wedding first. Like, I was like, we have all of that, but we haven't done that. And also, if we don't do that, then we can't get the DJ, and then I can't give him a date, and then I can't get the people that have the food. And then I just started, like, ranting.
Did you have like, a Snickers moment?
Yeah, he's like,
you were like a full domino topple.
It was crazy. Yeah, I just lost it for a second. I was like, we don't have anything. And he was like, well, we can figure it out in the next. I was like, no, we need to figure it out all right now. If we don't figure it out all right now, we're going to have all these things come at you like last minute. I do not. I was like, I'm not about to be here trying to plan the wedding in a month, like within a month. That's not happening. We're doing this right now. So I have been, for the most part, we've been together picking the stuff, but I've been like initiating most of it. So, and I didn't even think I was going to be that guy. I'm usually like, leave it to be whatever. We'll figure
maybe
it out.
Maybe this is your stepping stone to becoming a capital A adult.
I hope not.
We can't quite.
Maybe you're running down the aisle and you don't even know.
That, that's got to ascend to the capital letter.
Lord Jesus.
I think it's great. You know, I'm a big proponent of positivity and spreading love, and I try not to be negative. And even with the guys that work on the channel, like try to, you know, my guys don't be negative at all. There's too much negativity in the world, man. So I'm, first of all, congratulations
for sure
on all that.
Thank you.
So,
Thank you.
It's stoked that you found the yin to your yang, and always keep a Snickers in your pocket, man, until you get married. I don't know what to tell you, bud.
Yeah, I think so.
I think it's great. I think that wrestling is kind of what brought you guys together. What was that like when, and you know, kind of tell me a little bit about how you guys, made this work.
How we made the wedding work or how we met or
no, just in general, like you guys are both.
Yeah, go ahead, John. John can word it.
You guys are both doing the damn thing and making this life work. How did you guys meet up? How did the relationship kind of spark off? How do you guys work your schedules together? Like, how do you guys make it work within the industry like that?
Okay, so a little bit of everything. So we met at Action Next Up show. That was my first match that I was talking about earlier, but the tryout match after my graduation match. He saw me wrestle there, and he told me that he was like immediately attracted to me, and he was a champ at the time there. So I didn't even I don't even think I spoke to him because I was like, this is a champ, like he don't want to be bothered, you know. Like, little did I know. So after my match, I disappeared. Me and the boys, we went to go get food somewhere. So apparently he was looking for me, but I was nowhere to be found. So he slid in my DMs, messaged me, and he's like, hey, you did really well. You moved really well. I really liked what I saw in there today. And I'm like, okay, cool. But it felt like I was like, I know what this is. Like he's coming, he's trying to flirt. So I'm very like, okay, no, I'm good. Like, so I curved him. I was like, all right, cool, thank you, whatever. And that was that. Later on, he messaged me again, curved him again, and I was like, all right, I know what he's trying to do. He's trying to like butter me up and like try to get with me or whatever. And I was like, cool, appreciate it. Kind of like,
played it chill.
I'm like, yeah, brushed him off. And a few months later, there's a tournament. It's called the SEI tournament that they do every year in Tennessee. And I show up. I'm showing face. I went to go see it all comes full circle. I went to go see Billie Starkz. She was in the Futures tournament. they have a tournament of up-and-comers and just all over that they get. And Billie was in it. I was very intrigued by her. I also went to go see Daniel Garcia because I thought he was really cute and a good wrestler. He was in the main tournament. So I show up. It's a two-night tournament, and I'm very, like, go with the flow, hang out, we'll figure it out. So I ride up with a few of the guys. I get left there, and I'm like, oh, I'll find a room. I'll ask if I can sleep, like, end up with any of the people in the tournament. Or if push comes to shove, I'm an adult, I'll get a room, I'll figure it out. So I start asking people. Lowercase, of course. Yes, lowercase adult. I start asking a few of the guys that I know, and they're like, oh, we can't. We're rooming with someone, or we have something going on, blah, blah, blah. And I see my now fiance in the locker room. And I'm like, damn, okay. So I could ask him, but also he's a champion. Dilemma. And also he doesn't want to be bothered. But he did slide in my DM, so that's the opportunity. So I'd like go up to him and I'm like, hey, do you mind, like, would you happen to have room so I could stay, like, I'll sleep on the floor. And he was like, absolutely. You can sleep in my room. And I'm like, do you not need to ask nobody? Or, like, he's like, no, it's fine. It's
nobody fine. To ask.
Nope. And I was like, okay, cool. So show ends, and he's like, hey, we're not going straight to the room. Is it cool if you, like, do you want to come hang out and have some drinks? And I'm like, hell yeah. Like, what do you – it's my first year, and I get to hang out with all the people in the tournament, people that are on the indies, like top guys. I get to pick their brain. I get – not even, even if I don't get to pick their brain, I just get to hang out with these people. Like, I was like, what do you mean? I would love to go hang out and have drinks. I go out with them, hang out with Adam Priest, Cruel, Cabana Man Dan, with AC Mack, and a few of the people in the tournament. And I just get to, like, just see them all interact. It was the coolest thing. And we just hit it off from there. And from there, like they say, the rest was history. We clicked instantly. We got along, both chill, very, like, I like to be, like, spoiled a little bit. He took me out to dinner, like, did it the right way. Didn't push too much. Like, I was like, okay, you're playing your cards right. Like, I like this. This is great. And
proper gentleman doing the work.
Right. Like, putting chivalry in the work. Like, you know, it's yeah, a lot of, you know, now, especially with, like, social media and dating apps, everybody's just like, oh, do you, you know, just get to it or whatever. But I just liked how he went about it, and we just clicked ever since. We've gotten along, and it's just, we've made it work. Like, we've figured it out as we've gone, and I feel like it just worked because with him, I feel like anything that comes up or any issues or anything, we just resolve it. We just talk about it. It's a very mature love, mm-hmm. a love that I couldn't have at 18 or like 19, 20, you know, you're not mature enough, I don't think. At least I wasn't mature enough to be able to understand that people have flaws.
We're talking about being lowercase A's here. I don't know that I'm mature enough in my 40s. You know what I mean? Like, it is what it is.
Yeah, but you have to learn that, like, whoever you're with, they're going to have their flaws, and you're going to have to accept their flaws and learn to work with them. And, like, same for you. Like, nobody's perfect, you know? So, like, there's stuff that I do that absolutely probably annoys the hell out of him.
You have to find the right one where your demons interact properly.
Right, exactly. And we did.
Well, that's beautiful.
I love it. John, go ahead. Throw a question out there. And then I've got one more for you that I ask everybody. I'm looking at the time. It is getting a little late. I think you got time for just a couple more questions, and we'll wrap
up. Yeah, for sure.
Okay. John, what do you got?
Yeah. All right, so the one that I'm always interested in is your opinion on, you know, we've talked a little bit about how this era of independent wrestling is back to the old territories, and how this is a different feel for what the industry's doing. And where I don't know that you necessarily have to chase a contract for a big show to get famous or popular or get paid. What do you think is the biggest opportunity in the indies for the talents, for the companies, for the fans, for us to move this needle, like you said earlier, on the era that we're embarking on? where do you think the biggest opportunity for us to really push wrestling into this new era of indie dominance and territories really comes from?
Yes. So I don't know if this is how it was run in the territory days, but just like we're seeing a lot of the big companies kind of work together now, I feel like that is such a vital thing that we need on the indies. We need a lot of companies all over that group together, that work together, that work towards featuring more people, maybe coming together and as like a force and becoming like one thing, one big, like the in, how do I say this? A lot of promotions are unfortunately like worried about tearing each other down or like being the best one and like don't go here, don't go there, whatever, whatever have you. But I don't think it's possible for everybody, but if most indies just came together, started working together, cross promote, use talent all over, I think the indies could be a force to be reckoned with. We are seeing that with the top companies a little bit more now, like we saw with Bloodsport and GCW, WWE. We've seen that with AEW, New Japan, TNA, and a few other promotions. I can't think of them right now, but I know they've partnered with other promotions. We just saw an announcement with DPW, Prestige, and I forgot who the third one was. I don't know if it was West Coast Pro. They're doing a joint thing. So if we see a little bit more of that, I feel like it could really take off.
See, it's interesting that you say that, and here's why. Cha-Cha had the same answer last night. Basically, everyone that we've talked to in the United States,
everybody
has that same answer. Overseas, and this is a beautiful thing about what we do, is we're not, you know, we don't limit ourselves to just the States. We watch independent wrestling all over the world. In Australia, is an example. There's a group of like three or four feds that we have discovered that work together, and they don't promote same days. They use a lot of the same talent, and it's for the area. It's Adelaide, Australia. For that area, it's like the most southern tip of the country. It has boosted their business, not just in one fed.
A lot.
All of them that are working together and working collectively. We have seen this a little bit over in the UK. We have seen a little bit of this in Portugal now as we're starting to learn. It seems like we're a little late to the dance, but it's not too late. It never is.
Right.
And I 100% agree. And it doesn't even have to be a situation. Like Georgia is an example. We know there's 60 fucking federations running in Georgia.
Why?
Like, I get it. Like, it's a lot of places for a lot of people to work. But if you're drawing, you know, 20 people, are you really doing something here? Are you building a business or what have you? If some of these feds can consolidate down and like break this down regionally, right? Like in the southern region, you have five or six feds that. In this whole area, like cross promote it and make it happen. Coastal Championship Wrestling down here in Florida is doing something interesting. They they're over on the east side of the state in Miami. Well, they run that area. Now they've started opening up Tampa. Now they're going to open up Key West. And they're opening up. They're about to run this like it's an independent loop, probably 6 days a week, 5 days a week. If more companies can fall into that, or collectively come together, and you have stars in every area, so you mean not everybody's gonna make every shot, right? But it's possible.
Right.
It's super possible, and it's one of those things that. If we get on board in the United States and some of these major companies start doing it, we're going to be set. Independent wrestling will be completely set.
Absolutely.
Well, and in the era that we're in, I don't think that indies really need those big shows anymore. Those fans have access to indies like they've never had before. Yeah, with the production on the indies going up like it has been, like we see really pretty shows.
Yeah, even
for indies, like the production value on some of these indies is phenomenal.
Yeah,
you know, and the more value that they put into the production and the editing end, the more they put into the social media platforms and presenting their matches and their work, the more we're seeing those things become very popular to fans because that's where the fan base is. So they're gathering that community around themselves and they're building this up from the bottom. And that grassroots thing is always going to be stronger than, oh, it's the only option I have, so I might as well go buy a ticket.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, the last thing I've got for you, and we'll get ready to tie a bow on things. You have been a tremendous guest tonight. I believe this is a good show.
Thank you, guys.
This is one I could go on and on and on. one question I ask everybody when they come on, and in your situation, might be a little bit different because you have worked in a lot of prominent, you know, independent federations. You've been on AEW's Dark. You've done a lot in the period of time you've done it in. Out on the indies right now, give me – it's a two-part question. The first part is, you know, give me some of your bucket list matches that you'd want to have with people that are out there, whether it's in the States, whether it's internationally. What's that look like for you? We'll start with that one, and then I'll give you the follow-up.
So I'm just splitting it up in regions right now, like we're talking about territories. We're going to keep the theme. So down here in the Southeast, I have wrestled Adam Priest before on a smaller show, but I would love to wrestle Adam Priest on a bigger scale. He's been one of my favorites to watch. He's been on a lot of promotions I've been in, but he's somebody I always lean to and go to for advice, for like ideas or for structure, just in general. He's a really good mind for the business, and I think people are starting to figure that out. But he's a really good person, somebody I would love to have a match on a bigger scale. Malachi was on my list, but he got signed. He is somebody I looked at and I told him I want to be like, that's who I strive to be. I strive to be like you. He's just so athletic, so charismatic. So his presence is just, you can feel it. But he's signed now. So as far as the West Coast, Titus Alexander is
guy. That'd be crazy good.
Yeah, he is so good. So put, you could tell just like he feels himself in that ring, you know? And I love that. And I feel like that's somebody I could also learn from. Ali is out here now. Mm-hmm. Mustafa Ali. Mm-hmm. That's somebody. He's coming to Action this weekend, which is, I guess it's not my home promotion aside from the WWA4. I won't be there, which sucks, but that would be somebody that I would love to just, I would learn so much in just one match. Who else? Did we mention Darice earlier? I would love to have a match with Darice.
That would be killer. All of these are too, by the way. These are, and all.
My last one, I don't know if you asked for one or if you asked for a few. There's so many people. Any. But Masha Slamovich is somebody that I was in a rumble with her, and this sounds crazy, but I just want her to, I just want to like throw hands with her. Like, I just, because she does not hold back. And I love that. I love that. She's so good. She is so good. I know she, I think she's still signed with Impact.
Great talent, though. Good
fit. She is tremendous. She is a.
Oh, good.
Man.
Before my fiance retired, he wrestled her at his home promotion as a champion, IWTV World Champ. And as soon as that match was over, he came to me and I was like, how'd it go? And he was like, I will wrestle Masha any day of the week. And if I had a promotion, that would be my champ.
Yeah, she's, I mean,
high praise.
We've done spotlight. I did a spotlight show with Masha. Oh, Masha, excuse me. She is phenomenal.
Yes, so good.
The follow-up to that is, you know, I've never talked to you about this, so I preface this by saying he's being hit blind by this question, so if anybody has anything negative to say, you can at Fireside Page and I'll answer your tweets. If you had to give us some names that we need to go and take a look at, because a piece of what we do when we have these podcasts is there's so much really good wrestling that's out there, independent-wise, that there's stuff slips by us, right? Like, it's very possible to. So that's why this next question, it could possibly say, oh, you didn't mention me. If you had to give us doesn't matter how many names, a list of names for us to pull up and take a look at.
Yes.
Because
yeah, what's your watch list look like?
What you do when you do that is you not only give me that one name, you're also, because I pull, you know how I operate, I pull matches at random. I don't watch them, I don't look at them until I physically see them for the first time. So you give me that one name, but when I pull the match, it's going to give me that second name. So you're giving me five or six people, but you're actually giving me 12.
People that to watch?
Yeah.
Who's your watch list look like? When you're watching a wrestling match, who's your go-to pulls?
So I'm a pick people that I've had. Damn, I want to pick people that I've had matches with to put them on. We talked about the first person that comes to mind is Teriyaki. We talked about him when we did the when we were watching.
In May. He's going to be on a live stream in May.
Okay, perfect. I'm glad you guys have him coming in. That is somebody that
excited about that.
Yes, I always go to. I love picking his brain. Shout out to Teriyaki. That driver that you guys saw, that viral video that you guys saw, that was me and him coming up with that. Like, I was in the ring with him, and I was like, hey, I'm thinking about this, and I, like, kind of show it to him, and he, like, pieced it together, and he was like, this is what you need to do. And he comes up with stuff like that, like, just out of thin air.
Nice. All right, so, yeah, he's on the list. We're definitely pulling him in to watch some stuff back. So whoever you think of.
Adam Priest, I mentioned him here a little bit before. That's definitely somebody you guys need to be watching. Somebody that's not on everybody's radar, Rachel Armstrong. She is in the SCI tournament that we have coming up. She is definitely one to watch.
I like it.
I want to say she's in her first or second year. Just really, really good talent. Who else do we have? Damn, my mind is blanking right now.
Edit. Like he said, he prefaced this with, you're on the spotlight. So, you know, it's...
damn. Yeah, my mind is, like, completely blanking right now. That's the three I have right now, or two already, or I gave.
Okay, well, DMs, you know, that's how we communicate a little bit. Just shoot them my way. And like I say, we do that because it helps us, right? Because we do so many different programs, like, I can incorporate a little bit of everything. And, like, the names that you gave me.
You're everywhere, so you get to see a lot of talent, a lot of places, and maybe it's not on the radar yet. Maybe you see somebody that isn't, you know, getting the recognition that maybe their talent warrants. This is an easy opportunity for us to catch that and ride that wave too.
Yeah, for sure. I don't know, my brain is so scrambled right now with names and people that I've seen and just matches right now that are coming to mind, but I just can't think of, like, specific names right now. Okay. I don't know, I just went blank.
It's no worries. It won't come across as blank. How about that? Post-production's a lovely, lovely tool.
Yep.
All right, so real quick, John, you got one more? You have anything else for him before we tie a bow on it?
I mean, I think we've covered a lot of the other stuff. I really think that there's a whole lot of other stories, and you've been in so many places that we could really do a second show and cover, like, a lot of your, you know, we didn't cover any of your So in your career, in the stuff that you've done, what's a storyline that you've built with somebody that you're proud of, and how did that come about? What's the process of like building a story with you, and how the longer term thing plays off for you? What's that look like for you?
I love that question. That was something that I got to play with a little bit more at my training school at the WW4. Every Thursday, we would have shows, and it really, like, it's hard to be able to tell a story, especially a continuous story on an independent promotion that's running every month, because there's a lot of things that go into it. But the attention span of people is one thing. Trying to keep consistent and every month, sometimes people forget. So it was a little bit easier to do it weekly at the WW4, and I had just more creative control as champ. So I want to say the story I told overall as champion at the WW4, being double champion, was one of the ones that I was most proud of, because it was the most continuous over 1 year of just like, it was just, and it was not even the most crazy story. It was just the story of like, I scratched and clawed my way to this championship that I thought I should have had before. I finally get it, and then here comes the shiny new toy, teriyaki. And that's who you guys want to see. That's who you cheer for. So, like, before you all turn on me, like you do as a modern crowd does, as soon as the chase is over, they don't care about the baby face champ no more. I'm turning on y'all, and I'm turning on Terry. Before you guys, I beat you to the punch. You know, I turned on y'all before you turned on me.
I kicked you before you kicked me, huh?
Right. So that story, there was a lot more details that go into it. That was the overall story. Then I become double champ. I was supposed to build a faction. That didn't happen. But it's just it. I'm very proud of that story because I learned to, like, things change on the indies. Things change in professional wrestling all the time. So I learned to just become like water and just maneuver and like, okay, we can do this, but we now this tool isn't available this week. I don't have this person or this or that. So now I have to pivot, and now I have to do this, and I have to keep the story continuous, and you know, and just building that up for that year, and then dropping those belts, and the moment that I did drop those belts, it just, the reaction and the response it got was like, it just felt full circle, and it felt like all that work I put in just like came. It's crazy how we work to just that one moment of when I dropped the belts, but all that just meant so much, and the crowd, everybody was invested. Like, I was invested. Like, I was invested in, like, what the hell is going to happen? Sometimes I didn't even know what was going to happen next, and I was so intrigued and excited for that.
But I hear the enthusiasm and excitement when you talk about that. Mm-hmm. That's just one of those things that you're not ever going to forget, because you're 100% correct. That's the high that you chase in the wrestling business. Is that,
oh my god, there's nothing like it. Nothing like it.
I think that's anything athlete related, sports of all kinds. Like, you're chasing that championship moment. You're chasing the defense. You're chasing those moments. And the whole career of an athlete is never the spotlight. It's always those great moments, the immaculate catch, the snow domes, it's always those moments. Like, yep. You were saying, when you dropped the titles, you came full circle, and it felt like there was a closure on a story and a part. You got to finish that story part. And that's a big deal right now for everybody. And that's always been the case for athletes, to chase that one moment. And when you have it, then what do you do next? Well, you go for another one. And right. That's the thrill of being an athlete.
Right. For sure.
Mr. Rico, I can't thank you enough for setting aside the time to sit down and talk with us. And this is one of those situations to where, like, we could really go on and on and on. But
I do think there's enough cover. Here to there's, have you back on, yeah, for sure.
Down the line, if that's something that you want to do, we'll be more than happy to have you back on. For all of you that have made it this far, for starters, right above his head, it's at Rico94 Gonzalez. That is on X. That is on Instagram. That is on Pro Wrestling Tees. I'm going to need for you, if you haven't, I'm going to need for you to go ahead and plug that in, give him a follow. You can also find him over on YouTube. Is it Rico Gonzalez?
Yeah, just Rico Gonzalez. Or I feel like it's youtube.com/Rico94Gonzalez. I made all my socials the same.
Okay, well, it should be the same. If not, down below in the description video, you'll have a link to the YouTube page. The easiest way to support independent wrestlers is to go out there and give them a follow. Share their stuff when you see them tweet. Like, if they got YouTube, head on over and subscribe. It's free. It doesn't cost you anything. Just hit the button. And in this situation, if you can buy a t-shirt, that obviously goes a long way as well. So support independent wrestling, because they are the guys and gals that are out there giving us content to do our stuff on our channels here. So I would greatly appreciate it. Mr. Gonzalez, do you have anything you'd like to say to our viewers before we say goodbye?
Appreciate y'all for always watching, always following. Like he said, the easiest way you can support us is by liking, sharing, commenting, all that stuff. Appreciate y'all. Love y'all. That's all I have.
John, why don't you go ahead and take us home, my man? Or you got anything you want to say to Rico before you end it?
Absolutely. Do appreciate your time. We love having you on the show. It's always a pleasure when you're here. We enjoy our conversations. And I cannot wait to have you back on the show for sure. Like these guys have said, if you can't buy a t-shirt to support a guy, maybe one of your friends can, and they might not even know they exist until you share their content. If you enjoy it, then your friends might too. So go out there and push all the buttons, drop those savage elbows right there on the ding bell so you never miss a beat what we got going on behind the curtain. You guys know we've got new products, new shows, new talents always coming through here. You never know what's going on, but you can get behind the curtain with us and share your passion for wrestling while we share ours with you. Guys and gals, as always, we love each and every one of your faces, and we'll see you again next time.